Easter Sunday morning, Whatcoat family. Visitors, online members, and guests, if you're visiting with us, just wave your hand. And know that we want you to come back again, again, and again. Welcome to our resurrection service as we invite you into the presence of the Lord, into that special place, that special space in our hearts and minds. The very first Easter teaches us that life never ends and love never dies. A verse in 1 Corinthians asks, death, where is your sting? Sting, where is your grave? And grave, where is your victory? He got up. He got up so that we could get up. He got up with all power in his hands. In Matthew 28, Jesus said, all power, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. And so we thank God for the day Jesus took your place and mine. For I really believe that this is the day that grace happened. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe, is what John wrote. This Easter Sunday morning, let us pray that we're worthy and thankful of his many, many, many blessings.
Amen.
We praise you, Lord, for this special Sunday. On the cross, you changed the bitter sting of death into the greatest victory of all. We are Easter people, and hallelujah is our song.
Come on now, come on.
May the joy of the Lord strengthen us today. And I know that our preaching, teaching, soul-searching pastor, Reverend Archie, will help us further understand the promise of Easter, for Jesus Christ has risen from the dead.
Yes.
Now, look at the person behind you and just say, he got up.
He got up.
He got up. And because he lives, and because he lives, the Gaithers wrote a song we all know entitled Because He Lives. And the chorus goes like this: because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds my future. And life is worth the living just because he lives. You know it, so say it with me. Say it with me. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future and life is worth the living just because he lives. Oh Lord, conqueror over death, to hear you say it is finished is glorious. We confess with our lips that there is nothing we can do or say that will add to what you did on the cross. You are our only hope and salvation. Hallelujah.
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 Praise
Hallelujah.
God. And welcome into this sacred place as we, the Easter people, get up for the signing of the Apostles' Creed, followed by our opening hymn, Christ the Lord is Risen Today, on page 302 in our United Methodist.
And we'll sing the first four verses of that one.
I believe.
Amen. We want to thank Brother Nikolai for the accompaniment on the organ this morning.
All right. Woo!
Announcements for this morning are as follows. The beautiful flowers you see on the altar are given by Sister Roxanne Foreman in remembrance of a loving father, Brother Roland Foreman. Please contact Sister Sheila Griffin if you would like to place flowers on the altar. The lovely lilies on the altar this morning, in memory of Elizabeth Ferguson and Clarence Ferguson and Reverend Mildred White and Reverend C.B. White, were given by Brother and Sister Diane White and Sister Charles White. Go see the musical production Compassion Street, which will be shown at the Swartz Theater on Friday, April the 12th at 7:30 p.m. Information on purchasing tickets is on the flyer and on our bulletin board. Anyone interested in driving the van, we need you desperately, please contact Pastor Archie. Our Whatcoat prayer list is now on the hallway bulletin board for you to pray over our sick and shut-ins. Thank you to Sister Cleveland Wilson for decorating the bulletin board. And if you see names missing, please contact Sister Sheila Griffin or Sister Geraldine Thomas. I have an announcement for Men's Day. Men's Day is April the 7th. Suggested donation for men is $500. Suggested donation for women is $250. Feel free to give at any time. Yeah. And we have an announcement now.
Greetings on this beautiful Resurrection Sunday.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. I want to just announce that we will have a repast after service in honor of our confirmants, the young people who will be joining the church this morning and professing faith in Christ. So all are welcome.
Amen.
Greetings, my dear sisters and brothers, on this Resurrection Sunday. The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. I want to announce that we're going to have our new members class, a series of classes, starting next Sunday. There will be three classes. They will meet three consecutive Sundays at 9 o'clock a.m. So if anyone is interested in becoming a new member of Whatcoat United Methodist Church, please contact me and be prepared to join me on the next three Sundays at 9 o'clock a.m. We will meet in the back room in the Hardcastle room, and we will welcome anyone who wants to become a new member of the church. And so if the Lord and the Holy Spirit is moving on you and telling you, you need to make a firm commitment and profession of faith and join a local church, and you don't have a local church, I came here to tell you this morning, you found a good one.
Amen.
I was hoping to get a better amen than that.
Amen.
Thanks be to God. Thank you.
Selection from our melodious choir, followed by the scripture reading from Sister and Minister Datsy Adams, and then prayer by Sister Pat Randolph. Thank you.
Tomorrow, because
resurrection
yes.
day.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for that first resurrection day.
Yes.
We thank you, O God, because without that day, we would all be lost and mired in sin.
Yes.
Because you paid the price that day. You paid the price for all of us, not
yes.
just those that were watching
yes.
and were there. For those who did not see you, who those believe and yet did not see. We thank you, God.
Thank you,
we
Lord.
Thank you for all the blessings,
yes.
for grace,
thank
for
you,
mercy.
Lord.
We thank you, Lord.
Yes.
We thank you for even the hard times, because the hard times is when we learn
yes.
and know to trust and believe and let you carry us. Let you be the only footsteps in the sand, because you are carrying us through
yes.
those hard times,
yes.
through those trials, and
yes.
bringing us out to the other side. We thank you, O God, for this house of worship, for these people, for this shepherd, for all of those in leadership. We pray for the leadership of our country, O God. We pray for all leaders everywhere, Lord, because our world is without you right now. They are not trusting and believing in you as you have asked them to do. So, God, we pray for them that they would turn their eyes and hearts and minds to you and rule in the way you want them to rule, not by their own thoughts and deeds. God, we just thank you now. We ask your blessings on all those that are sick, all those that are in nursing homes, all those that are alone this resurrection day and may not know you in the pardon of their sins. Send your spirit out, God. Because
yes.
you are everywhere, Lord.
Yes.
You're not just here in this place. You're in every church, every house, every home, every mud pond, everywhere, God. Because this is your world. You made it. You let us live here, but it belongs to you. So, God, we just thank you now for what you've done, for what you're going to do, and what you're still doing right now in our lives and in our homes and in our hearts. God, we thank you. We thank you in the name of Jesus. My soul says amen.
Amen.
Ought to say glory, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Somebody ought to say thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
How many of you know that life is worth the living
yes.
just because? because Jesus lives. Pray with me, church. God, we give you thanks on this Resurrection Sunday. We give you thanks that though your son Jesus was crucified and though he lie in the grave, we know that on the third day you raised him from the dead with all power in his hands. And for that, oh God, we say thank you. We thank you, God, that you raised us, for when we were down in the muck and the miry clay, when we were dead in our own trespasses and sin, God, it was you that picked us up, you that turned us around, you that placed our feet on solid ground. And for that, oh God, we say thank you. We thank you, God, that we're able to come for yet another Easter, another Resurrection Sunday. Some of us didn't make it. Some of our sisters and brothers didn't make it to see another Easter. But for us, oh God, we say thank you that we're able to come into your house yet again, able to sing the songs of Zion yet again, able to pray the prayers of the faithful, able to hear your word read and proclaimed. We thank you, God. And God, we give you thanks for all the blessings you bestow upon us. Everything that we have belongs to you, oh God. And so now we give back to you a portion of what you have blessed us with so that we might be helpful and useful for building this kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Bless all that we have to give, oh God. Multiply it 30, 60, 100 fold so that all that we give might be used to help somebody know that though the wages of sin be death, that the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ. And if a man be dead, yet he hath Christ, that he shall live again. Do all these things for us, O God, and we'll be careful to give you glory and give you honor and give you praise that you so rightfully deserve. Bless our giving now, O God, in the name of the one who gave his life on Calvary's cross, namely Jesus, your Son and our Savior. And the Church of God says, amen. Amen.
Come on in.
things come of thee.
Thank you.
all right to praise the Lord. About how he died for me. And when I think about how he set me free. Aren't you glad that you have a voice this morning to be able to praise his name? Isn't he worthy to be praised? We had 1,000 tongues, it would not be enough to be able to give him praise. Majesty, dominion.
Yes.
Pray with me, church. God, we thank you that we're able to stand here on this day. That you have brought us thus far along the way and you promised that you would never leave us nor forsake us. And that the work that you have begun in us, that you will take it on to completion in Jesus. So be with us, O God, as we continue to praise you through hearing your word proclaim. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight this day, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. In the name of the one who rose from the grave with all power in his hands, the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, we pray. And the church says,
Amen.
We've given God praise, and we've remembered God working through his Son, Jesus Christ. On Maundy Thursday, we remembered that sacred meal that he had with his disciples. He told them that he would not eat of that meal until he eats of it in the kingdom. And then on Good Friday, we celebrated a tenebrae service, a service of lights. As the lights got dimmer, we remembered that Jesus is marched to the grave. But all along the way, we knew, even as our hearts were heavy, as we put ourselves in the place of the first of Jesus' disciples, we knew that there was light at the end of the tunnel. Even along the way, when we remembered that they would pierce him in his side and place nails in his hands and in his feet, we knew that there was light at the end of the tunnel. Even when they whipped him with a cat of nine tails, even when they mocked him and scorned him, even when they pressed down upon a crown of thorns upon his head, we knew that there was light at the end of the tunnel. As we celebrate this Resurrection Sunday, we rejoice in resurrection power. The power of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This is the day that marks the pinnacle of our faith. It marks the triumph of light over darkness and life over death. But most of the time when we tell the Easter story, we talk about it as a three-day event, or we think about it as beginning with Holy Week and ending on Easter Sunday, and when we shout hallelujahs. We think about Good Friday, the day he was crucified. We think about Holy Saturday, the day where Jesus lay in the grave. We think about Easter Sunday, the day when Jesus rose from the grave. Yeah. But if we think through the timeline of the Easter story, we find that there was a crucifixion and a resurrection, but it began with a baptism. Yeah. Where you going with this, preacher? I'm so glad you asked. 3 years before Jesus died, he was baptized by John the Baptist in the Jordan River. Now, oftentimes we don't usually associate baptism with this week, because the truth is, 3 years might seem like a long time, even in our life. Tell me what you were doing 3 years ago.
Well.
Many things happened in Jesus' life in 3 years of ministry. Between his baptism in the Jordan River by John the Baptist and now his grave experience in the garden tomb. Sometimes we get so wrapped up with how a story ends, and the ending is glorious indeed, but we forget how the story begins. Oh, that'll preach. Think about your life. Think about even where you are right now. Some of you are praising God that now you are in Christ. Now you are in church, not just on Easter Sunday, but every Sunday. You praise God that now you know the word of faith. Now you call upon the Savior. Now you're filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. But the story had to begin when you said yes to God's will and yes to God's will. And even as our confirmands will come in a few minutes and recognize and take possession of Jesus as their own Lord and Savior in front of this august congregation, it had to start with baptism. One day their mothers and fathers and grandparents and sponsors and godparents brought them before the church and said, "We want this child to be baptized. We promise to raise this child in the Christian faith." And the congregation said, "We will help you raise your children in the Christian faith." Yes. It started with baptism. Even for Jesus, it started with baptism. Now, Jesus was not baptized because he had committed sin. He said to John, he said, "Allow it, because this is the way to fulfill all righteousness." He had to come by the way of baptism and by the way of the cross before he was able to be resurrected with all power in his hand. See, some of us want to have the power of Jesus. Some of us want to have the glory and the light of Jesus. Some of us want to be able to do the works of Jesus, but we had not yet put ourselves in a position to say, "Lord, here I am, a sinner in need of your grace." We have not said, "Lord, that baptism, that baptism that I went through, I now understand that it washed me from all sin and unrighteousness." When we connect the two, baptism and resurrection, give me Romans chapter 6, verse 4, and this is what it says. It says, "Therefore we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live or walk in the newness of life." It starts with those of us who have been identifying with Christ through being baptized by water and the Spirit. It starts there, and then it is a journey. You see, this Christian walk that we go through, it is not a sprint, but rather a marathon. There are going to be some highs, and there are going to be some lows. There are going to be some difficult times, and there are going to be some joyous times. There are going to be some trials and tribulations and perils and distresses along the way. But you got to hold on believing that God is with you. Yeah. The same God that says, "I won't leave you, nor will I forsake you," is the same God that even when we reject him, he never rejects us. Even when we find ourselves far away from God, it's not because God left us, but because we left God.
Right.
You heard in the gospel reading this morning, the truth is that even Peter, who rejected Jesus, when Jesus rose from the grave, he told the women to go and tell the disciples and Peter, Sister Datsy, go tell the disciples and Peter that I have been risen.
How about that?
How is it that this God who loved us so much, this God, this Jesus who made sure that even Judas was fed at the table, this God who took Peter, the chiefest of the apostles, and even after he had denied that he ever knew Jesus, in the end it says he cursed. He says, "I don't know the blanking man." That's what he said. But God, in God's grace, God in his mercy. How many of you need grace and mercy? He redeemed Peter. And that same Peter who denied Jesus three times, Jesus restored him. He says, "Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you even love me? And Peter, do you even love me?" Somebody may have come here this morning to get restored. By your actions and by your words, you have strayed far from God. Some of you, like Peter, may have even cursed God. And yet I'm here to tell you this morning that no sin that you have committed is too deep, too grievous, that God can't forgive.
Amen.
Give me 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. This is what it says. It says, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant," what? "Mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." It is by the mercy of God.
Yeah.
It is by the unmerited, unearned favor of God that we are able to sit in God's house on today and give God praise and honor and glory. We didn't do it. God did it. We didn't save ourselves. God saved us. It was the first Easter at evening when Jesus came huddled with the huddled disciples in the upper room. And in this upper room, it would become the center of spiritual power in just a few days. But at the time, it was far from that. The disciples were behind closed doors, and the Bible says it was locked because of their fear of the Jews. So many of us are working in fear, right? We're afraid of everything and everybody. Afraid to even do what the Lord has called us to do. Won't open our mouths and share the reasons for the hope that lies within us because we're afraid of what somebody might say and what somebody might think. Y'all know I'm telling the truth.
Go ahead, preach.
They were afraid. The cries of the mob had prevailed and Jesus had been crucified. In fear of Rome squelching a rebellion, the people desired blood, sport, and Rome obliged. It was prime time now for Jesus' enemies to finish off his followers. They just knew that now that they got rid of Jesus, they were going to hunt down and kill the followers of Jesus as well. We know how quickly this mob can get out of control. The disciples probably thought it was inevitable, just a matter of time before the crucifiers would be coming for them. See, some of us can't stand up for what is right and just because we're afraid of what somebody might do. Rather than trusting in the power of God to sustain us, I hope I'm preaching to somebody. Instead of the church gathered for worship, they were the church huddled in worry. Let me say that again. Instead of being the church gathered for worship, they were the church huddled in worry. Powerless and fearful of what the future hold, they were no doubt disillusioned and downcast. That describes some of us. Their Messiah was no more, or so they thought. Their dreams of the kingdom of God were shattered. They had left everything to follow this Jesus. And now, what were they going to do? They're feeling like the two disciples on the road to Emmaus. We thought that this Jesus was the one, but maybe we were wrong. Some of us might think that way in faith. We thought once we gave our life to Christ, it was going to be a bed of roses. We thought that once we said, "I do," to God's will and God's way, everything was going to get easier. But I'm here to tell you this morning, you have not read the Bible. He said what they did to him, they're going to do to us.
Yes.
But in their sorrow, Jesus came and spoke words of peace. Not just the peace being the absence of conflict, but the kind of shalom peace. A peace that means that you're whole and lacking nothing. You see, when you know who you are in God, when you know what God has done and what God is doing and what God is going to do, and if you know that God is with you, you don't care that the whole world is against you. You see, my sisters and brothers, when you're anxious, when you're troubled, when you're down, the only thing that can claim your heart is the peace of Jesus. The one who said, "Peace, be still." The one who calmed the raging sea is the same one who can calm the anxious heart.
Yes.
May Maybe now the disciples can remember when Jesus had told them in this same upper room a few days ago, words we need to remember. He said, now is your time of grief, but I will see you again and you will rejoice.
Amen.
Blessed are those who mourn. Give me Revelation chapter 1, verse 18. This is what the Lord says. I am the living one. I'm he who lives and was dead, and behold, I'm alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of Hades and of death. Some Bible scripture versions say, I have the keys of hell and death. See, Hades sounds a little too soft for me. I have the keys to hell and death. I like that one because some of us know that in this life we're going through hell right now.
Amen.
And you need to know that this God that we serve, this Jesus who is the Lord of glory, says, I have the keys to hell and death. Jesus is the only person to have his epitaph announced by angels. Weeping women and mournful men came to the tomb in which his lifeless body had been placed. They came to bury their hope. They were there to say farewell to a dream. They were there to embalm their past. They were there to weep and to mourn. For you see, church, these defeated and dispirited followers of Christ were representatives of all of humankind's hope. But they were met by angels at the tomb who said, don't be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. As he said, I'm told that today when you visit the empty tomb in Jerusalem, you can see written on that door. Recently, somebody just wrote on that door at the entrance for security purposes, he is risen. What an epitaph. For you see, church, the resurrection is God's yes to the world's no. The world says, no, you can't live forever. The resurrection says, yes, you can. The world says, no, you can't live victoriously with hope. But the resurrection says, yes, you can live with enthusiasm for your future. There might be somebody who came this morning downtrodden, downcast, face down, couldn't believe all the cards that you have been dealt in life. But I'm here to tell you that you have victory in Jesus' name because he rose from the grave with all power. He says that if I be lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men unto me. Resurrection of Jesus is the cornerstone of our faith. It is not merely a historical event, but a profound demonstration of God's power over sin and death. I know so many people, and you know some folk like that too, who have overcome so many things in life by the power of Jesus. They've overcome death, they've overcome divorce, they've overcome distress, they've overcome addictions by the power of Jesus. They hold on to God's unchanging hand. Through Christ's resurrection, we are assured of our own resurrection and eternal life. Death no longer holds dominion over us. We have hope beyond the grave. You see, when you know that this life is not the only life there is, you live differently. You see, you try to get all the things that the world can afford when you think that this is all that there is. You think that all these things out in the world that seem enticing and shiny, and the devil tells you that those things are going to fulfill you, and then you find that those things might satisfy you for a moment, but ultimately they bring you no peace. Ultimately, they bring you no joy. Ultimately, it does not open your heart to a love that is greater than anything that this world knows. Only Jesus. Give me Jesus, not this world. Everything in this world is going to pass away. Everything is going to rot or rust or lose its value. Even the folks that you're trying to impress, one day they're going to have to answer for their faith as well. Don't be caught up on what everybody else says and what everybody else thinks. They got their own worries and cares. You make sure you're right with the Savior. You make sure you've got resurrection power. You make sure that you are an Easter people. Give me John chapter 11, verse 25 and 26. This is what Jesus said to the woman when he raised Lazarus from the dead. He said, I am the resurrection and life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. And then he asked her this, do you believe this? So I came here to ask you this morning, once again, Easter people, do you believe this? Do you believe that if you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, if you believe that his suffering, death, and resurrection saves you from sin, if you believe in what he has done, that atoning work on Calvary's cross, then you shall have a victorious life in the here and now and eternal life in the days to come. Some of us say we believe it, but we don't act like we believe it. We don't live like we believe it. We don't talk like we really believe it. Easter is a testimony to the love and mercy of God through Christ's sacrificial death and subsequent resurrection. We are offered forgiveness of sins and reconciliation with God. There's somebody here today, I'm sure, that you believe that your sin is keeping you away from God, and that is the truth. But I'm here to tell you that because Jesus died on the cross of Calvary, you can be forgiven your sin. He says, I will remember your sin no more. All right. That's good news.
That is good news.
That's good news to sinners like me. He says, I will remember your sin no more.
Yes.
He says, I will separate you from your sin as far as the east is from the west.
Yes.
Throughout the Lenten season, we pray, Lord, create in us clean hearts and renew right spirits within us. What would it look like if the folk of Whatcoat United Methodist Church came forth from this day forward and lived as victorious Easter people? What if everybody around us saw the glow on us and they said, well, what is it you're wearing that produces such glow? And you say, well, that's the Holy Spirit living in me and through me. What if you told them that you were saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Spirit, and then they said, what must I do to be saved? And then you can say, let me tell you about a man. Let me tell you about a man who loved me so much that he went to Calvary's cross and died. This man picked me up. He turned me around. He placed my feet on solid ground. Talk about amazing grace. How sweet was the sound that saved a wretch like me. One day I was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. Are you ready to tell the story? The empty tomb is not merely a symbol, but a historical reality, attested to by numerous eyewitnesses. Jesus rose from the dead, defeating sin and death once for all. Give me 1 Corinthians chapter number 15. It says, but now Christ is risen from the dead and has become first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive. That's called the great reversal.
Yes, yes.
Adam, the first human being that God created, sinned, disobeyed God. He and his wife Eve, when they ate of the tree in the midst of the garden, that God told them, when you eat the day that you eat thereof, you shall surely die. He brought forth death and sin into the world. He brought forth disobedience of God into the world. But the new Adam, the second Adam, if you will, was Christ, who came to redeem all of humanity, to put us back into a situation so that those of us, all of us who are created in the imago Dei, the image and likeness of God, shall be restored to the image and likeness of God. How do we do it? Not by our own power, not by our own might, but by the Spirit. Just as the women found the empty tomb, so too do we find hope in the risen Savior. The resurrection is the foundation of our faith. It validates Jesus' claims, and it affirms his deity. Let me leave you with this. Jesus levels with us about our problem. We have a collective problem. Every one of us share this same problem. Luke chapter 5, he says, it is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. that he has come to call to righteousness.
Wow.
He came to call sinners to repentance.
Yes.
So I ask you this morning, have you repented?
Yes.
Have you changed your mind from being a worldly mind to being a godly and holy mind?
Yes.
He didn't come for those who think they've got it all together. He came for folk like me who know I need a Savior. Our problem is sin. Your problem is sin. My problem is sin. Jesus said the reason he came was to call sinners to repentance. We sin, and in rebellion, we break the law of our Creator God. Sin is lawlessness, 1 John chapter 3, verse 4. But here's the good news. The resurrection breaks the back of sin and death. We can now say, O grave, where is your victory? O death, where is thy sting? No matter how dark the night may seem, the light of Easter shines brightly, offering hope to the hopeless and joy to the sorrowful. As we celebrate on this resurrection day, let us remember we're called to be beacons of hope in a world that desperately needs the light of Christ. His resurrection power fills us with hope, fills us with courage, fills us with joy as we journey through this life. May we be witnesses to the resurrection in both word and deed. Christ is risen, and he's risen indeed. So be it. God bless you. Amen.
Thank you.
God, we thank you. We praise you. We lift you up. We magnify you. We glorify your name. God, these are your Easter people. These are your resurrection people. These are your believers, O God. These are your prayer warriors, O God. These are those who are filled with your power, O God. These are those who have the courage to share the good news in a world that knows way too much bad news. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon them, O God. They're waiting, waiting to hear a word from you, waiting to know that you are with them, that you've not left them, that you've not forsaken them. We're waiting, O God, for you to do a revival move. This won't be our doing, but yours. We're waiting, O God, that the church will be packed like this on every Sunday. Waiting for that time when we have to say, preacher, can't we have two services or three services? Waiting for that time when we say, preacher, we need a midweek service too. Waiting for that time when all the churches, not just what, but all the churches are packed with people who are seeking to find God's will and God's way in their life. God, we know that the signs are near. There's always war and rumors of war. Natural disasters in diverse places. We don't know the day nor the minute or the hour when the Son of Man will come again, but we see the signs. We know that the second coming is near, O God, and so do a good work in us, O God, so that we might make ready a people for the coming of the Lord. Bless us so that we might be a blessing to others in all that we do, dear God. Be with those who grieve, O God. Let them have a peace that passes all understanding. Be with those who are depressed and oppressed, O God. In the midst of all their trials and tribulations, give them a joy that passes all words. Our hearts are not as loving as they ought to be, O God, but give us a love, your love. Remember that new commandment you gave us, that we should love as you have loved us. And then those in the world will say, see how they love one another. These are true disciples of Jesus Christ. Bless us, O God. We thank you and we praise you as we pray the prayer that you taught your disciples when they said, Lord, teach us to pray. You taught them to pray in this manner. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I want you to rise, even as you remember that Jesus rose from the grave with all power in his hands. Take that power with you, knowing that God is with you, and it doesn't matter if the whole world is against you. Go forth as Easter people. Hug somebody and tell them you love them. Hug somebody and tell them you love them.
Let us tell them all about our trouble.
give all grace and honor and glory to God because he has done a wonderful work, not only in my life, I'm sure in yours, in this congregation, and he's provided us with wonderful leadership, a wonderful servant. Pastor Archie, he's provided us with a gifted and talented musical director who keeps us on our toes. And when you see us up here, it's normally after just one rehearsal. Amen.
Amen.
So Pastor was kind enough to allow me a couple of seconds to pay homage to someone, and I said I couldn't let this occasion pass us by. We are confirming three young people who will be read in as official members of Whatcoat United Methodist Church today. Amen. And to Sister Althea Armstrong, if you are watching, and I'm not going to cry.
Come on now. So, come on, go ahead.
She joined this congregation in 1963.
Yes.
She taught confirmation for 30 years, and I'm sure some of her former pupils are in these pews or watching online. I know that my children were two of them, and it was when my son was confirmed that she invited me to join the confirmation team. He's now 27, so it's been a minute. And so we are building back better post-COVID, amen? This is the first confirmation class since COVID. So again, all glory and honor to God because he directed us and he provided us with young people who were willing to spend 12 weeks under my tutelage. This is my first time doing it by myself and I prayed a lot. but Pastor talked about us not being people of fear. So I had to step out on faith because I knew these young people needed that spiritual guidance.
Yeah.
And I'm going to tell you, Pastor found them worthy as members. So I will defer to you, Pastor, for this service. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you. Amen.
Raylan and Billy and Aubrey have studied and prayed and worked. Let me tell you about some of the things that we talked about. And I was impressed that they had good understanding about things like grace, about the redeeming work of Jesus Christ, about the Holy Trinity, God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, about five membership vows, prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness.
Yes, yes.
They learned about sin and grace, about how all have sinned, about how none are righteous before the Lord. They learned about God's forgiveness of sin, and God giving us strength and motivation to live without sin. They learned about the two natures of Jesus Christ. They learned that Jesus is both 100% human and also 100% God. They learned about the Holy Spirit as our helper, our comforter, our helper, our guide in this life of holiness. They learned about life after death, reward of heaven and eternal life. They learned about creeds like the Apostles' Creed and the Nicene's Creed that guard against heresy.
Yes.
And they promised that they would tell their story. I even asked them, I said, do you all work? And they said, no, we don't work. I said, but when you do get a job, you're going to make sure that you give a portion to the Lord's church, right? I hope I'm preaching to somebody. And finally, they learned about their spiritual journey in Christ. They learned that this, what they will experience today, is just the beginning not the end of the journey, and that they're called to continue to grow in faith through practicing the spiritual disciplines of studying God's word, praying, fasting, staying together with God's people for worship and fellowship, and sharing good news to this sin-sick world. And so we're ready now to confirm these young people, and you should have one of these booklets here that is the confirmation liturgy. And so let me invite our confirmands and their parents and sponsors to the front. Sing it like you mean it. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price. Through confirmation and through the reaffirmation of our faith, we renew the covenant declared at our baptism, acknowledging what God is doing for us and affirm our commitment to Christ's holy church. Who presents these young people for confirmation? Amen. And so I will ask you a series of questions, and if you agree, you will respond, "I do." On behalf of the whole church, confirmands, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sins? Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? According to the grace given to you, will you remain faithful members of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representatives in the world? Will you, who sponsor these candidates, I'm speaking to the parents and sponsors, will you sponsor, encourage, and support these confirmands in their Christian life? Congregation, do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ?
We do.
Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include these persons down before you in your care?
With God's help, we will proclaim good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround these persons with the community of love and forgiveness, that they may grow in their trust of God and be found faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them.
Let us join together in professing the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of both the Old and the New Testament. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended
Universal Church, will you be loyal to Christ through the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries?
I will.
Confirmands, as members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness?
I will.
Congregation, members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. Confirmands, we give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love as members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church. We renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. The God of all grace, who is called to eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you that you may live in grace and peace. Let the church say.
Amen.
All right. Ask the sponsors and parents to move out of the way, if you could, to the side. And I want the confirmands to just turn so that everybody can see. Can you just turn around? Let everybody see who you are. Thank you, confirmands. Thank you, parents and sponsors. Thank you, teacher. Said and done in this service of worship. Let us rise together to sing our final hymn, and it's on number 310 in the hymnal, He Lives. I want you all to sing it like you mean it now.
Yeah.
Go forth from this house of prayer knowing that God is with you. That even as he raised his son Jesus Christ from the dead, so you have the same power through the Holy Spirit to live a life of holiness. Go forth as Easter people. Go forth as people who know that we shall also be resurrected. Live this life as an abundant life in the here and now, and the eternal life in the days to come. May the peace and blessings of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit forever rest, rule, and abide over all of our lives now, henceforth, and forevermore. Let the church say,
Amen. Amen.